Hey guys, so today we're back in Jonah chapter 3. So where Jonah chapter 2 finished off was Jonah getting spit out by the great fish onto the dry land. And from there is where we jump into the text. So it says this in verse 1, "The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time." So this should be an encouragement to us where Jonah, in the beginning of the book, God gives this prophet of God a message. And he completely disobeys and goes in the wrong direction and does his own thing. And it says that the word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time. And, you know, that's just a blessing to hear, to know that even when we make mistakes, so often God offers second chances. So we think about like Peter, when he denied Jesus 3 times, Jesus still restored him and allowed Peter to be used by him in the future. Now, we shouldn't just take the fact that God is forgiving as a license to sin. So sometimes people look at this and they see, oh, well, they gave God gave Jonah a second chance, so that means I can do what I want. God will give me a second, third, fourth, fifth chance. It doesn't matter. Where what we need to be careful of is not only the fact that just because God can give a second chance does not mean that he always will give a second chance. And not only that, but the fact that God gave Jonah a second chance should not be a license to sin because, well, I'll get to do this again later. God will give me another opportunity. So whenever we think about this, yes, it's a huge blessing to know that just because we make one mistake doesn't mean that we cannot be used of God ever again. But we also need to keep in mind that whenever we do mess up and make mistakes, when we repent of our sins and ask to be forgiven, we are forgiven in that moment through Jesus. But sometimes the consequences of our sins can continue to come back up. So just because God loves us doesn't mean that we won't have to deal with sometimes not getting to be used in the same opportunity as we were beforehand. But in this case, in Jonah's case, he did get a second opportunity. And so often in our life, God does give us multiple opportunities to do the task that he is calling us to do. But, you know, what we said earlier in chapter 1 is still true in chapter 3, which is he would have saved himself a lot of heartache and a lot of pain had he just been obedient at the start. And that should go for us as well. As yes, it's a blessing when God gives another opportunity for us to serve him, but it would be much better if we were just obedient at the beginning instead of waiting until a problem arose. So often in our culture today and in every generation previously, people have been more concerned oftentimes about what they want to preach about or what the congregation wants them to preach about. And not that there isn't a time and a place to, you know, go with felt needs and stuff like that, but ultimately, the only voice that should truly matter as far as the message that is given is God's voice. So I've heard a lot lately from different groups that will talk about what will the world think about this decision that Christians are doing? What will the world think about this or that? But ultimately, what we should be asking is, what does God think about this? Because the world and the side of all these decisions doesn't really matter. If God's opposed to something, we should be for it, and vice versa. And we get messed up whenever people say, well, what's the world going to think? And that's probably, you know, sometimes these people that are watering down the truth or trying to sweep it under the rug because they don't want to address the sin issue or anything like that, that's going against what God has laid out for them to do. And in the same way, you know, it might have been quote-unquote easier for Jonah to just say, hey, just do your thing, Nineveh, and it'll be okay. But no, he had to be obedient to what God said. And God told him, go to that great city of Nineveh and preach the message that I tell you. And it says in verse 3, Jonah got up and went to Nineveh according to the Lord's command. So Jonah went to Nineveh according to God's command. And as we discussed previously, Nineveh, capital of Assyria, pagan, evil nation. It was a Gentile land. You know, the Israelites are Jewish. They have no religious commonality, no real moral commonality in a lot of ways. So these were people that Jonah did not want to preach to. He wanted God's judgment to come on them because he saw the wickedness that they had. But this is a unique story because it's rare in the Bible where in the Old Testament we see somebody going somewhere outside of Israel to preach the gospel. Now, Israel was supposed to be a light to the nations so that the nations would see Israel and come to God through that. New Testament, we are to go into all the world and make disciples of all nations. But in the Old Testament, they were more localized and the people came to them often. But in Jonah's case, he went to them. And this is a great reminder that in the Old and New Testament, God is concerned for the souls of all people. And he had different ways of communicating that message. But it was always because he wanted everybody to be saved. So although Israel was entrusted with this blessing at the outset, it was not to keep it to themselves, but God gave Israel the message to communicate it to other people. So Romans 3:29 says, "Is God the God of Jews only? Is he not the God of Gentiles too? Yes, of Gentiles too." And Mark 16:15 says, "Then he said to them, go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation." So what we need to realize is that God, although obviously not happy with their sin and will judge their sin, he loved the Ninevites. He wanted to save the Ninevites just like he did the Israelites. And that's why he sent Jonah, not just to spare them from physical pain, but to save their souls. So verse 4 says, "Jonah set out on the first day of his walk in the city and proclaimed, 'In 40 days, Nineveh will be demolished.'" So this was probably not the entirety of his message. Now, it could have been, but there's at least a good chance that this was a summary statement of the message that Jonah preached to the people of Nineveh, and this was communicated in verse 4. Now, if this was all that Jonah said, and he just continued to repeat it, then that was all that was needed, and they realized the severity of what was going to happen to them had they not repented. So verse 4, we see, though, that it took a message from a prophet letting them know what the problem was. And that's what we need to understand is when sharing the good news, you first have to share the bad news. That's something so often in our culture, we want to skip the bad news. And we just want to say, hey, yeah, you know, you're good just the way you are and you don't need to change anything. And if you want to come to God, that's great, but he'll accept you either way. The fact is we need to let them know, yes, God loves everybody, but our sin separates us from God. That's the bad news, and everybody sins. But the good news is Jesus paid our price for us. He paid for our sin so that we could have a right relationship with a holy and a righteous God. And so if we forget to say the bad part about how our sin separates us from God, then the good news doesn't necessarily become good news because people don't see their need for a savior if they don't see anything they need to be saved from. So in verse 4, whenever it says, "In 40 days Nineveh will be demolished," what Jonah is doing here is he is addressing the fact that trials are coming their way, that the city of Nineveh is under judgment for sure, and he gives them 40 days of a time frame to let them know of what's ahead. So 40 in the Bible is oftentimes the number of testing. Throughout history, people have kind of seen specific numbers in the Bible as having a general theme behind them, and 40 is oftentimes seen as the number of testing. So in Genesis, we see that it rained for 40 days and 40 nights. We see in the book of Numbers that the Jewish spies were sent out to explore the land of Canaan for 40 days. We see in Deuteronomy that the nation of Israel was tested in the wilderness for 40 years. In 1 Samuel, the giant Goliath taunted the army of Israel for 40 days. And here, the Lord gave the people of Nineveh 40 days to repent and turn from their wickedness. So oftentimes in the Bible, God uses 40 as a number to exemplify testing. So verse 5 says, "Then the people of Nineveh believed God. They proclaimed a fast and dressed in sackcloth, from the greatest of them to the least." So it says that they believed God. And now some people question whether this was unto salvation or just that they believed that the message that God said through Jonah was true. So some people think this is the greatest revival in history, where this entire massive city, or the majority of this massive city, trusted in the living God. Now, other people would say, when it talks about how they believed God, that they were just believing the message that God spoke through Jonah, so that they weren't actually saved, but they were being receptive to this message of coming destruction. So because of that, it says that they proclaimed a fast and dressed in sackcloth. So fasting, giving up food, is typically what we think of for fasting, and it's a way of getting rid of something to focus on something else, and in this case it would be our relationship with the Lord. And it says that they put on sackcloth. So sackcloth was like a coarse cloth, often made of goat's hair, and it was worn by the poor or by people who were in mourning. So we see people in the Bible wearing sackcloth as a way to express their mourning. So for instance, Jacob expressing his grief after his son Joseph, he thought was dead, he put on sackcloth. And Jonah, after he experienced the loss and the trials in his life, he put on sackcloth as well. So the prophets oftentimes wore sackcloth as well, and this may have been partially to identify with the poor and outcast of the society, but it also very well could have been as a way of mourning over the sins of the people, that they were calling them to repentance, and that they were mourning over the sins of the people that they were preaching to. So this was not the typical dress of the people in that day, but they were wearing it as a way to humble themselves before God, to show basically, I'm nothing, you are everything, please have mercy upon us. And that's what we need to be thinking of as well when we come to God, and not just when we're really asking for a big favor, although, you know, that helps, but just in all circumstances, we should be completely humbling ourselves before Him, knowing who we are inside of Him. Sometimes people get these big inflated egos thinking that, you know, God should just be so thankful that I'm a Christian because look at how great I am, when really we should be the most humble of people when we recognize how sinful we are, that it was because of my sin that God had to send His own Son to die on the cross for me. That should be a humbling thing, not something we should be arrogant about, but thankful that God would save a sinner such as I. It says in Matthew 12:41, "The men of Nineveh will stand up at the judgment with this generation and condemn it, because they repented at Jonah's preaching, and look, something greater than Jonah is here." So Jesus was basically saying that the Ninevites will stand up at the day of judgment and condemn the scribes and Pharisees, because whereas the Ninevites, from one short sermon, chose to repent and turn to God, the scribes and Pharisees heard Jesus preach time and again. They saw miracle after miracle, and they still chose to resist, reject, and condemn the Son of God. So for the people that are thinking, if I would have lived in Jesus' day, I would have believed, there's no saying whether that's true or not, because Jesus was saying how actually it brings greater judgment having greater light and resisting it and rejecting it. And the fact is whether it's a little or enough, God gives enough to all people so that they could understand the truth and come to a relationship with Him. So verse 6 says, "When the word reached the king of Nineveh, he got up from his throne, took off his royal robe, put on sackcloth, and sat in ashes. Then he issued a decree in Nineveh, by order of the king and his nobles, no person or animal, herd or flock, is to taste anything at all. They must not eat or drink water. Furthermore, both people and animals must be covered with sackcloth, and everyone must call out earnestly to God. Each must turn from his evil ways and from his wrongdoing." So they wanted to show the genuineness of their desire for mercy by fasting, by sitting in ashes or in dirt, I think some translations say. And this is, again, just a way of humbling themselves before God, asking for His mercy, relying not on their own deeds. They didn't say, hey, you guys, Jonah, we all know that he's just telling a fable. That's not actually going to happen. And then they didn't say, well, we think it might happen, but we need to pray to the pagan gods, or we need to just work harder ourselves. They just threw themselves completely at the mercy of God and said, please, you know, have mercy upon us. So we see that from the king to the peasant and everybody in between, this was a decree issued from the king, but it was meant for all people. There was nobody who was too good for this, because the king, thankfully, recognized the fact that everybody in that city was going to be held accountable to God, and they all needed to cry out to him for mercy. So verse 9 says, who knows? God may turn and relent. He may turn from his burning anger so that we will not perish. So they were saying the reason why we're doing this is because there's a chance that God would relent from the disaster that he had said he would do. So verse 10 says, God saw their actions, that they had turned from their evil ways. So God relented from the disaster he had threatened them with, and he did not do it. So some people think that history is just written in stone, that God wants certain things to happen, and there's nothing that can affect any part of it by human decision or prayers. Now, obviously, God has a purpose and a plan that man cannot thwart. So it was in God's perfect will that the Son of God would die for the sins of the world. And there was nothing that was going to stop that. But there are opportunities in life when we pray intercessory prayers that God really can move and that he can work in that situation. So in Jeremiah, this is a great verse that speaks directly to this passage in Jonah. In Jeremiah 18, 7 through 8, they address this in a great way. It says this, at one moment I might announce concerning a nation or a kingdom that I will uproot, tear down, and destroy it. However, if that nation about which I have made the announcement turns from its evil, I will relent concerning the disaster I had planned to do. So what God is saying there is he's saying clearly that he has a plan that he will destroy this city or this community or whatever. But if those people will turn, will repent, and announce the evil that they had done and call upon him, that he will relent from that. Now, this goes to the whole point of, does God know what his indecision will be? Does God know that the Ninevites will eventually repent? Yes, God knows the future events. He knows everything. The end from the beginning. So he already knows what the outcome will be, but that does not change the fact that people in time can affect how God is functioning with us. So God knew the future events, but he also knew that had the people not repented of their sins, that he would have gone through and destroyed the city of Nineveh. So it's not that God is unclear on this. He's saying, though, that because of their choice, he was making the choice to spare them of the destruction that he had told them he was going to commit. So again and again in the Bible, we see that God is receptive to the actions that people make, that he is responsive to the creation of how people act. So God knows every future decision, but that does not mean that he is not giving us the freedom to choose those decisions. So when it says God saw their actions, that they had turned from their evil ways, so God relented from the disaster he had threatened them with, and he did not do it. That was not a fake threat. That was not just, he's just talking. He was literally going to destroy Nineveh. But because the people repented and fasted and turned to God, it says that because of that, he relented of the destruction that he was going to send. So don't think that prayer or fasting or asking God for anything is just going through the motions, that it actually doesn't change anything, because it can. So the people of Nineveh realized that if we repent, God may relent. And by that, you know, if we repent of our sin, God may relent of the destruction that he was planning to bring upon them. And this once again shows the kindness of God. It reminds me of Ezekiel 33 verse 11, which says, I take no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but rather that the wicked person should turn from his way and live. Repent, repent of your evil ways. So God is saying he takes no pleasure in the death of the wicked. Okay, this is not like his favorite thing, but because he is holy and just, he will always punish sin, deservedly so, but he is also merciful and kind, not wanting any to perish. So he gives us an opportunity to trust in him. So with this, we see that God gives us this opportunity to serve him. So some people question whether Nineveh genuinely turned to God, because shortly after this book, apparently there was still much paganism and turning back to idolatry and things like that. So they question if it was real or if they were more turning to God in terms of trying to not be judged, but not necessarily for salvation. A lot of people think that this was a great movement of God where people were saved. Regardless, though, and I would say that it would seem to be that they were genuinely saved, but it just says that they turned to God, and I think that would mean that they were saved. But regardless, one thing that's not really up for debate is around 150 years later, it's recorded in the book of Nineveh, in the book of Nahum, that the Ninevites were eventually destroyed. So God delayed his judgment on Nineveh 150 years because of their repentance, but he did not delay it forever. Eventually, once they continued and came back to their wicked ways, he would eventually punish them for that. So we shouldn't think that because God's judgment is slow in coming, or we don't seem to see any ramifications for rebellion or sin, that it will not come, because it will surely come to those that don't repent. So Nineveh is a great reminder that even the most wicked and sinful people, if they will turn to God, God will have mercy upon them. He will save them, and he will spare them from the judgment that was upon them. And so that's a something that we need to constantly reflect upon, is the fact that God is merciful toward us, that Jesus made a way available to save lost sinners. And that's not just a nice Bible truth, but that's something we need to apply to our life by trusting in him for our salvation. But if we are running away from God's will for our life, like Jonah did, which sometimes people say, well, what's God's will for me? I don't know what God's will is. And that might be a good message for another day. But the first thing that I know for every person, sometimes we say, well, I'm not sure if it's God's will that I go to this school or this job or that job or whatever. But one thing I know for every person is it's God's will that you would be saved. So if you are not saved right now, you're disobeying God. You're like Jonah back in chapter 1, who's running away from God's will. And my encouragement for you would be to just cry out to God, have mercy upon me, a sinner, and put your faith in him to save you and him alone. And God will, on the authority of the Bible, if you believe it, not just saying those words as some magical words, but if you truly believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, that he died on the cross for your sins, then you will be saved. So I hope that as we are reflecting on Jonah, we can be reminded of the fact that even the most wicked sinner, if they will turn to God, God will have mercy upon them. And we will be looking at the closing of chapter 4 next time. So until then, have a blessed time.